Yeah, I couldn't agree more. An arms race in the Middle East sounds like pretty horrifying stuff. Thank you so much, Dr. Bluth, for coming on the programme today. It is a very complex situation, and who better to help us pick over it than friend of the show, Dr. Alan Mendoza, co-founder and executive director of the foreign affairs think tank, the Henry Jackson Society. Now, Alan, first of all, do you think that it's worthwhile getting back around the table with Iran, or are they a lost cause at this point?
Well, they are pretty much a lost cause ideologically and what they wish to achieve. But actually, of course, it's worth having negotiations with them to see if a permanent nuclear deal can be done. And I do stress the permanency of any deal that ought to be done. The problem with the previous deal that you mentioned was that, of course, it was sunset clauseed. It was going to expire after a certain period. And if basically you're dealing with a bad faith actor like Iran and you want to secure compliance and a deal going forwards, then you want to have a deal that has permanency enshrined within it. And I think if we can get to that stage where there is a permanent deal with Iran, which also includes some other aspects which were ignored in the original deal, that is certainly better than having no deal. But conversely, as we of course know from all the Brexit debates, no deal is better than a bad deal. And we shouldn't be going back down the path of a bad deal that was signed in 2016.
If we don't end up coming up with a deal with Iran, and there are people who are saying that, you know, it's moments away from actually enriching enough uranium to be able to create a nuclear warhead, how much of an existential threat is that to the West?
Well, it's a big problem in multiple ways. I mean, the first problem is that you have just a problem of proliferation full stop. The more countries that proliferate, the more will want to proliferate, and therefore you'll end up with a nuclear arms race, essentially, particularly in a volatile region like the Middle East. That's not a good thing. And if you then fast forward and imagine nuclear launches or something of that kind, or even purposeful ones, you can see that has repercussions for us straight away. Secondly, Iran has been hugely problematic as a country for our interests many years. We know, for example, that its activities in the Persian Gulf know that it frequently blockades the Straits of Hormuz and stops, you know, kind of trade going through there. We know that in the past it's engaged in hostile acts against British forces in Iraq and other places. And of course, it menaces Britain's allies, whether those are Israel or the Gulf states, Saudi Arabia. We know that Iran is bad for our strategic interests. Now, if it's bad now, imagine how much worse it would be with a nuclear umbrella to protect itself against. Again, no one's suggesting we would ever use nuclear weapons against Iran, but the converse is certainly true, that they will use nuclear weapons as a way to push their own activities regionally and, of course, further afield internationally. And let's not forget, Alex, you know, here's a country that has been employing terrorist tactics, either through Hezbollah or the IRGC, in overseas territories to attack all sorts of people, including civilians. And as such, who's to know if it were to be targeted against us. Now, if they had a nuclear weapon, what could we realistically do about it, is the question to ask.
So if Tehran doesn't want to play ball and these talks essentially collapse because no sort of sensible deal or anything of real meaning can be brokered, what should we do next? What would be the next step? I mean, would there be a need to resort to some sort of military intervention to smite down Iran, to prevent it, taking drastic action to prevent it being able to create a nuclear warhead?
Well, if it continues to proliferate, as it is doing now, in terms of at least trying to get to the point of getting into that bomb, it's clearly in breach of its, its treaty obligations under many ways. And yes, we would expect there to be UN Security Council resolutions about Iran to make sure that Iran is brought to heel. Now, that would be in the official channels. I'm sure unofficially there would be all sorts of activity on the lines we've already seen. Cyber attacks, attacks on key installations, the killing of terrorist leaders or people involved in that plot. There would be measures taken, I'm sure, to stop this terrible eventuality of Iran getting hold of the bomb. But the key thing to remember is that Iran is in breach of its treaty obligations by acting as it is. And as a result, the international community, the onus is on us to stop it from getting to that end point. And that, when I say us, I mean not just us here in the UK, but the entire international community, which says that this would be a bad thing in general. So from that perspective, I would hope we would have strong international concerted action. But if necessary,
the conflict areas outside Iranian territory and would feel more secure against potential attacks from the United States or other countries to stop these activities from happening. So overall, it is in the interest of the international community and the interest of Europe as well that the conflicts in the Middle East are stabilized and that there is no additional nuclear capabilities. Repeating the point I made earlier, it could be other countries then that will also think they can no longer rely on the United States. They need to have their own nuclear capabilities, and that could be extremely dangerous.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. An arms race in the Middle East sounds like pretty horrifying stuff. Thank you so much, Dr. Bluth, for coming on the programme today. It is a very complex situation, and who better to help us pick over it than friend of the show, Dr. Alan Mendoza, co-founder and executive director of the foreign affairs think tank, the Henry Jackson Society. Now, Alan, first of all, do you think that it's worthwhile getting back around the table with Iran, or are they a lost cause at this point?
Well, they are pretty much a lost cause ideologically and what they wish to achieve. But actually, of course, it's worth having negotiations with them to see if a permanent nuclear deal can be done. And I do stress the permanency of any deal that ought to be done. The problem with the previous deal that you mentioned was that, of course, it was sunset clauseed. It was going to expire after a certain period. And if basically you're dealing with a bad faith actor like Iran and you want to secure compliance and a deal going forwards, then you want to have a deal that has permanency enshrined within it. And I think if we can get to that stage where there is a permanent deal with Iran, which also includes some other aspects which were ignored in the original deal, that is certainly better than having no deal. But conversely, as we of course know from all the Brexit debates, no deal is better than a bad deal. And we shouldn't be going back down the path of a bad deal that was signed in 2016.
If we don't end up coming up with a deal with Iran, and there are people who are saying that, you know, it's moments away from actually enriching enough uranium to be able to create a nuclear warhead, how much of an existential threat is that to the West?
Well, it's a big problem in multiple ways. I mean, the first problem is that you have just a problem of proliferation full stop. The more countries that proliferate, the more will want to proliferate, and therefore you'll end up with a nuclear arms race, essentially, particularly in a volatile region like the Middle East. That's not a good thing. And if you then fast forward and imagine nuclear launches or something of that kind, or even purposeful ones, you can see that has repercussions for us straight away. Secondly, Iran has been hugely problematic as a country for our interests many years. We know, for example, that its activities in the Persian Gulf know that it frequently blockades the Straits of Hormuz and stops, you know, kind of trade going through there. We know that in the past it's engaged in hostile acts against British forces in Iraq and other places. And of course, it menaces Britain's allies, whether those are Israel or the Gulf states, Saudi Arabia. We know that Iran is bad for our strategic interests. Now, if it's bad now, imagine how much worse it would be with a nuclear umbrella to protect itself against. Again, no one's suggesting we would ever use nuclear weapons against Iran, but the converse is certainly true, that they will use nuclear weapons as a way to push their own activities regionally and, of course, further afield internationally. And let's not forget, Alex, you know, here's a country that has been employing terrorist tactics, either through Hezbollah or the IRGC, in overseas territories to attack all sorts of people, including civilians. And as such, who's to know if it were to be targeted against us? Now, if they had a nuclear weapon, what could we realistically do about it, is the question to ask.
So if Tehran doesn't want to play ball and these talks essentially collapse because no sort of sensible deal or anything of real meaning can be brokered, what should we do next? What would be the next step? I mean, would there be a need to resort to some sort of military intervention to smite down Iran, to prevent it, taking drastic action to prevent it being able to create a nuclear warhead?
Well, if it continues to proliferate as it is doing now, in terms of at least trying to get to the point of getting to that bomb, it's clearly in breach of its, its treaty obligations under many ways. And yes, we would expect there to be UN Security Council resolutions about Iran to make sure that Iran is brought to heel. Now, that would be in the official channels. I'm sure unofficially there would be all sorts of activity on the lines we've already seen: cyber attacks, attacks on key installations, the killing of terrorist leaders or people involved in that plot. There would be measures taken, I'm sure, to stop this terrible eventuality of Iran getting hold of the bomb. But the key thing to remember is that Iran is in breach of its treaty obligations by acting as it is. And as a result, the international community, the onus is on us to stop it from getting to that end point. And that, when I say us, I mean not just us here in the UK, but the entire international community, which says that this would be a bad thing in general. So from that perspective, I would hope we would have strong international concerted action action. But if necessary, I'm sure individual countries would take whatever action they felt necessary to stop Iran from getting the bomb.
Well, it's fascinating, the beginning of this process, and it could be a critical moment in history. Let's see what happens. Dr. Mendoza, thank you once again for being on the show. We, of course, are going to follow this story as the talks continue. Now, after the break, COVID booster jabs will be offered to everybody 18 and over.